weekend it lives here in Victoria, and they were relating back to how long they've been living there since 89, and some say something like, that not very long in adult years. And when I say that we've been living in, we lived in the Czech Republic, formerly called Czech Republic, now I have to get used to the new name. It's not Czechoslovakia, we got used to that one, Czech Republic, now it's Czechia. We were there 8 years, so that's kind of like a little less than a quarter of my life, but it's half of my kids' life, or almost the majority of our youngest's life in Prague, the capital of that country. And we headed over there with the goal of starting churches that Czechs would want to make more of after we left. Now, to give you an idea of what we were starting with in that country, only 0.3% enjoyed the grace of Jesus already. 0.3%. So if I were to take a 10-meter cake and count it out, that would be the entire population of the Czech Republic. 10 million people or so. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So that's the distance. Imagine that's the entire population of the Czech Republic. If you want to ask how much is 0.3%, that's 3 centimeters of that much distance. If you wanted to find someone, if you were hungry for something, you were searching spiritually, you were hungry for something, you would have to comb through 400 people in the Czech Republic to find one person who understands the grace and the love of Jesus. So when we went there with this goal, we went as a team, there were 8 adults. This goal of trying to start churches that Czechs we wanted to make more of, that's all we had. We didn't realize that they called it the heavenly language because it takes you forever to learn. We didn't realize exactly all the obstacles that we'd be facing. And so we needed to learn 3 really important things. The first thing we needed to learn was to ask people for advice. We called it treasure hunting. And we would go around, we would visit. We visited maybe about 15 missionaries that were already in the country, 15 Czech church leaders, and maybe about 60 non-believers. And we would ask them the question, our goal is to start a church that Czechs would want to make more back to me. What advice would you give? And it's amazing what people will do when they're asked for advice, especially non-believers. We got some of our best tips for how to start a church from non-believers. And it was fun just to learn to listen and to soak in that knowledge. And it was like when you start an 8,000-piece jigsaw puzzle, which I don't do very often, and you lay it out, you're just like, where do we start? I don't know, let's just start finding the edges and the corners. And that's what that first year was like for us. The second thing that we needed to learn was we needed to learn to pray more than we ever had in our entire lives. If you want to ask me more about what that means, I can tell you all sorts of things about what the journey of the Lord took us on to learn to pray more and to depend on Him more. Because in Canada, I was a youth and worship pastor for 12 years, and I'm a big guy, and I know how to be energetic, and I know how to get it done. But when you're standing there in front of such a massive jigsaw puzzle in a new country, I had to start my day by saying, Lord, what do you want us to start with now? What do we do next? What do we ignore? What do we do? Because I can't just do this by my own John power. I need to see God-sized things happen here. The third thing that was so crucial for us is as a team of missionaries, we needed to learn to love each other despite all of our quirky learning faults. There's a saying that says missionaries are like manure. You keep all together, they just smell awful. So you need to spread out so they can do some good. And the thing we learned is that God's idea is communities and team and people learning to love each other. And when people learn to love each other, despite mistake at first, the manure turns into a rose garden. And that becomes fragrant and beautiful. So we were 2.5 years in the Czech Republic into our mission. And as a team, we had about 60 to 80 non-believing Czech friends around us in varying degrees of spiritual conversation and varying frequencies, I could say. And they also 2.5 years had failed. And we had not much to show for it. When we were desperate enough, we realized, let's stop trying. Let's take a week off of ministry and efforts. It'll be a fast from ministry, and let's fast from some other things as well. And just ask God, open some doors for us here. What do we do next? Because we don't know what to do. All we've got is 8 of us that love each other, and no clue how to move forward. So Friday, our fast closed. Saturday morning, I got a call. Hey John, I've taken some friends to go see some really cool stuff in the east part of the country. I think you'd be really interested in it. Some of my missionary friends don't want to go, and so the two of you want to come with us. We went on that trip. This was invited by a missionary friend. We went on that trip, and as we were visiting, one guy was telling us about Discovery Bible Study. We never heard about it before. We sat there and we looked at it and go, that's what we're going to do with our unbelieving friends. That's it. That's how we're going to come to Jesus, because all of our learnings and failures and conversations was able to just recognize it right on the spot. And then we went up to another city. We drove across the entire country. It took us about 4 hours. And we went to the next city, and we sat down with another family, and he was a very odd situation. He's a third generation believer. He was a pastor of a normal church, and then he grow to 50 and 80 people, and would always have a fight, because pastoring checks is like pastoring cats. They just want to go their own way. And so they never get bigger than that, so he thought, I need a big, better building. And he was an electrical designer, so he built an awesome building, and still, they could only get between 50 and 80 people, because people's social velcro was completely saturated, and they had no desire to reach outside of the church after the church, after about 80 people. At least that's what it was for 10 people. And so he decided to start something new, which was self-churches that met in people's homes, and that would live together and function together as a supporting kind of network. And as we listened to him, we're like, oh, that's the future. That's the future. After people become believers, that's what the future is going to be. And that's how God began the church that now exists. There's two elders that are our Czech fellows that are leading things. And when we left, there were two self-churches meeting and attempts to start other self-churches and Discovery Bible Studies led by Czech people. There's more details I could share, but I'll stop with that. There's sometimes that would be exciting. But what I wanted to get to was this. As these new believers reflected and looked back at how they came to Jesus, not only could we see that it was God's sovereign accidents bringing us across their path, story after story is completely accidental how we met the people that became believers, including we tried to do an outreach in the park with Marianne's. And when we were cleaning up and disappointed, the lady came along and said, hey, what's going on? And later she and her husband became believers through the Discovery Bible Study in one of our missionaries on our team. It was just completely accidents. So we saw God's hand organizing things beyond our control. And also, they told us this. What drew them to read the Bible, what drew them to figure out who Jesus was, is they looked and they saw the love between us as missionaries. And they said, what's going on with that? And when they spent time with us in our home or when we were together, they're saying, I haven't even experienced love like this in my family, let alone with my friends. What's going on with this? And to be honest, when they told us these years later, it's exciting to hear that the love between believers attracted people to figure out who Jesus was. But I couldn't figure out exactly what they meant. Like, why does it feel so loving? What do you mean? And I realized it's like if I was a fish and someone said, what does water feel like? I'm like, the thing that I live in all the time, it just feels like it. Because I'm a pastor's kid. I've grown up in a loving home. I've grown up in churches that, although they had faults, people loved around us. There's an atmosphere of love. And these people were saying, being here feels like we're in water. It's just so refreshing. to replace myself, find missionaries who are ready to go all over the world. And in my travels, I've been to various continents and various cultures, but one that I didn't understand very well was the Islamic-Muslim context. And so I asked some of my friends who are missionaries in Turkey if we could go, if I could go visit there to get an understanding of what the culture and the situation is there. And one of the cool things that I got to do on that trip was to go to the city of Ephesus. You know, the book of the Bible, Ephesians, is written to Ephesus, and I got to walk on stones that maybe even Paul walked on. And as we're walking around the city on a really hot day, my one friend that I was with was a little bit too tired, and these two tour guides were sitting under the shade of a giant pine tree, which was huge. The foliage was just like thick, impenetrable by the sun. And so my friend got invited to sit under the tree by these two tour guides just to chat. He wanted to do that. He's too tired of the sun anyhow. And so I went out walking because I wanted to see a few more things. And I came back, I was standing sort of out of range. And the fellow said, "Come sit in the shade." They kind of had that look of friendly and cool. "Come sit in the shade." And I'm like, "Oh, it's okay, I'm all right, I'm all right." And I thought, you know, I'm a pretty big guy. This is really, really beautiful over here. If I hadn't stepped from the sun into the shade of the fig tree, I wouldn't have known how beautiful it is. And I think that's what happened to our friends in Prague. They were standing over here saying, "Why would I want to go sit over there? I'm strong, I stand on the line over here." And we invited them over and they went, "Wow, this is really refreshing. This is really beautiful. I've never been in water before. I've never been under such shade." Well, I want to move into the passage that we're going to look at. And we're going to come back to the mention of a vine tree, a vine and a fig tree. And there's symbols in the Bible of this beautiful, peaceful place of refreshment when you're at peace with the Lord. Today, not just to tell you about things in Prague or about things in Turkey, but to think, how do we get ready to invite people into the shade of our fig tree? How do we get ready to help people experience that amazing, refreshing atmosphere of love? So that you can begin to put in your mind, and you can discuss this at the Bible study later this week, that we are a royal priesthood. We are all priests, which is really weird, because usually in the Czech Republic they would say, "Oh, so you're not a priest?" I'd say, "Kind of, but I have four kids and one wife." According to the Bible, those that follow Jesus are our priests. And anyway, so that's why I had that text read ahead of time. Some of you are so apologies that I didn't warn also the slide people that we're going to have that text read. So here we are in Zechariah chapter 3, verses 1 to 10, we're going to read. And just to give you a little bit of context for this book, if you were to read the entire book of Zechariah, you would feel like you had woken up in a psychedelic dream. It's like, what's going on here? Like there's like a bright present right now, because we're talking about dates and kings and things. And then there's like, there seems to be a near future promise that the characters in this book are going to taste. And then there's like this mystery box promise of something way in the future. We're not quite sure what's going on here. There's a branch and there's a seven-faceted stone that's maybe got fountains of springs coming out of it. And then there's also something in this text that you feel an ever-present reality that this is for the people of God. This is for me. This book is for me. So if you read that whole book, you feel like you're in a psychedelic moment. And in fact, this is one of the psychedelic moments. It's a vision that Zechariah has, that he's given. And seated before Joshua. Let's pretend you're the associates, and you're kind of here. In the ESV, it calls them friends of Joshua. And then there's also a future vision of the branch, or the stone with many facets on it. So I'm going to read the text through the ESV first, because I've said that's what you're familiar with here. Then I'm going to, because I'm familiar with the NIV, I'll be reading it again a second time after that as we go through the text. So, the imagined scene, as I've laid it out for you, feel the drama, and imagine that you are Joshua in this royal court. Then he showed me Joshua, the high priest, standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan, standing at his right hand, accusing him. And the Lord said to Satan, "The Lord rebuked you, O Satan. The Lord who has chosen Jerusalem to rebuke you. Is not this a brand plucked from the fire?" Now Joshua was standing before the angel of the Lord, clothed with filthy garments. And the angel said to those who were standing before him, "Remove the filthy garments from him." And to him he said, "Behold, I have taken your iniquity away from you, and I will clothe you with pure vestments." Zechariah, and I said, "Let them put a clean turban on his head." So they put a clean turban on his head, and they clothed him with garments, and the angel of the Lord was standing by. And the angel of the Lord solemnly assured Joshua, "Thus says the Lord of hosts, if you will walk in my ways and keep my charge, then you shall rule my house and have charge of my courts, and I will give you the right of access among those who are standing here. Hear now, O Joshua, the high priest, you and your friends who sit before you, for they are men who are a sign. Behold, my servant the branch. For behold, on the stone that I have set before Joshua, on a single stone with seven eyes, I will engrave its inscription, declares the Lord of hosts. I will remove the iniquity of this land in a single day. In that day, declares the Lord of hosts, every one of you will invite his neighbor to come under his vine and his fig tree." Look at this text a little bit more deeply. At the beginning, there's a vision. Zechariah has been shown this thing. He showed me Joshua, the high priest, standing before the angel of the Lord, Satan standing at his right hand side to accuse him. Satan standing ready. Have you ever had someone in your life who's ready to accuse you of something? Maybe it was an enemy at work who saw you making a few mistakes and they wanted your job, so they wanted to get you fired. Have you ever had someone at school? Have you ever had someone in your family who would always tell you what you did wrong? How bad you were? Have you had your inside voice that tells you what a lousy person you are? Thus Satan, the accuser, was getting ready to rip in Joshua. And listen to what the Lord does. The Lord said to Satan, "The Lord rebuke you!" He hand checked Satan right into the board. Bam! And he was out. They had to haul him off on a stretcher. The Lord says, no accusing going on here. He says, "Is not this man a piece of wood that I snatched from the fire?" If you say, "I rescued this guy, you're not touching him." And in fact, it says there, who has chosen Jerusalem. He's talking about a whole lot of people that he's chosen. Joshua is very symbolic of a whole lot more people than just Joshua. And he said, "This guy I have snatched from look at the word for filthy here, it's not just kind of like, you know, we're down by the beach and I got sand on my jeans from on my knees from the sea and I smell like smoke because we had a campfire. It's not that kind of filthy. In Prague, we experienced varying degrees of filthiness. They were learning to pick up after the dogs as we got there. They had new laws that you need to pick up your dog. And not always were they successful. And when we're in Prague, look at those buildings, it's so gross. When you feel that, more than slippery mud, under your foot. And I remember going to school, Mallory stepped in and hit some. I was like, oh my God, that's so gross. And I was like, leaning her feet on some grass, and then I was like, no! It's not even that filthy. I was walking our dog Sawyer in a ravine. I heard it was really beautiful, and I should take my dog there. So we drove, I was in this beautiful ravine. We were walking through the woods, and in the woods, all of a sudden, that's gross. Come on, sir. Let's go. And you know, I let the dog go free. You know, dogs, they go free and they go around and they find things. Anyway, I was marching through the woods a little bit further. I'm like, again, the sewer smell. This is, I'm going to go further. So we go further on the ravine. And this is a stinky place, I thought. And I kept quite clued in that, you know, there's sort of this, it came in my head as my dog came in. And so I'm like, let's get out of here, sir. Let's go. This is a stinky place. And we get back. Giving you new stuff. I'm giving you new clothes. I'm giving you clean outfits and a clean turban, and that means they're ready for service for the Lord. They're ready for full service with the Lord. And so Zechariah says, he needs to get fully ready for the hat on, too. And so the angel of the Lord goes, bring the hat, right? You don't want to forget the hat. And he is fully ready to serve the Lord. There is a total refit of Joshua from being accused, guilty, and full of shame and filthy, and he is totally fit and ready to go there. And if you read through the scriptures about how we get saved, this is what God does. We are a piece of wood snatched from the fire, filthy, and he just cleans us up, and then he says, now I got stuff for you to do. In advance for you to do. Ephesians chapter 2, 8 through 9 there. You read there. You get saved first, or you're dead, and now we've got good stuff prepared in advance for us to do. And this is what God, when the angel of the Lord gives this charge in verse 6 to Joshua. This is what the Lord Almighty says. If you will walk in obedience to me and keep my requirements, then you will govern my house and have charge of my courts, and I will give you a place among those standing here. You notice it's not the opposite, in that he doesn't say, listen, if you're good enough, I'll stop being angry with you. He says, I have stopped. I love you. You know, you tasted it. I've taken away your shame and your guilt. Now, walk in my ways. Walk in my ways. One of our elders in Prague had a beautiful way of describing what it means to walk in the Lord's ways. He was on his way to Jesus, but he was already obeying God through what he was reading in the Bible. And I hadn't seen him for a long time. He hadn't been able to meet because he had been sick and his job had taken away. He was a manager for rock bands. And one night he was sitting in a music club where their rock band had been playing, and he felt the Spirit of God. He heard the Spirit of God talking to him even before he was a believer. And the Spirit of God told him, go sit at the bar and get ready to talk to the manager. And so Paul was sitting there at the bar at near midnight, and a stranger walks up, a Czech guy, and says, hey, what do you think about God? And I was like, you're a non-believer, and you're a Czech, and you're asking what I think about God. And Paul starts telling him, well, I'll tell you, when I do what God wants me to do, I like it, and these are my experiences. When I stole a plate from a restaurant and I returned it, it was a really awesome experience. And this is what I'm thinking about God. And the guy said, yeah, but why would I want to obey God? For the sake of letting you do whatever I want. But God, because it feels better to obey God. It just does. When I obey God, it feels better. To walk in God's paths will feel good. And God says here, if you walk in obedience and keep my requirements, I'm going to give you a significant place in my house. You're going to be doing stuff for me. If you have governed my house and have charge of my courts, and I'll give you a place among those standing here. He says, I've saved you for a purpose. I've got a job for you to do. I've got good works for you to do. And if you stay on track with me, you're going to feel significant in this world. And it's good because I'm giving you really important stuff to do. And beyond that, God is also saying, it's kind of like this is part of the psychedelic moment where you're like, okay, what's he talking about? It could be this. I think that's often the purpose of scriptures, where it's sort of like you can imagine all the things that it might be to help you think about all the things that it probably is. He's saying, I'm giving you access. I'm giving you standing with these people. You're going to be in this council. And I'm also giving you access to their council. If you want to serve me, you're going to need advisors. And you're going to be a part of my heavenly council. I'm going to help you do the job that I've assigned you to do. And then there's this beautiful vision. I can get my coffee that's right beside you there, Ella. Could you bring that up to me in the front? Or maybe now, because that would be affecting her anymore. My voice is getting on the edge of the job. I haven't talked about this a lot in a mutual way for a long, long time. He says, this is a cool future vision is the high priest Joshua, you and your associates seated before you, you who are symbolic of things to come. This is, I think, it feels a whole lot like 1 Peter chapter 2. You are the royal priesthood. You are. You are all priests. Beginning to be like me, at least if you're a guy, have a wife and four kids if you want. Or you go for more. You were a symbolic of things to come. I am going to bring my servant the branch. See the stone I have set in front of Joshua? There are seven eyes on that one stone, and I will engrave an inscription on it, says the Lord Almighty. I will remove the sin of the land in a single day. As I began to study and review this passage, I remember sitting there with 10 friends who hear about Jesus the first time and go, oh, no way. Really? Can you imagine being Zechariah and you don't know exactly who the branch is? He's still a mystery box for you. You're like, the branch is coming? And he's kind of, it's kind of going to be like this stone with like seven springs coming out of it or seven eyes. We can't tell because it's one of those like multi-word meaning kind of things in the text. And it's just like, wow, this sounds fantastic. And the sin of the land is going to be taken care of in a single day. Associates, this is a vision of the future. In verse 10, in that day, each of you will invite your neighbor to sit underneath your vine and your fig tree. Because you will have stood before the Lord in your shame and your guilt. And you know what it's like to be defended by the Lord with that fierce love and that compassion that says, give me new ones. Give me that. I've prepared you for service, walk in your ways, and this is what you're going to do. You've been so refreshed. You have peace with me, and you have had time in your land to grow a huge fig tree. There is a vine. Have you ever seen like pictures of Greece and stuff, where there's, or in Spain, where there's this like sunny and somebody has a portico or something like that, and there's like vines growing across, and there's beautiful shade, and kind of rustic, and you reach up and you just grab a piece of fruit? That's the picture here. When you have peace with God, like Joshua experienced with God, you just have this beautiful garden, and you just go, hey, it's how I want you to experience what I've experienced with the Lord. So as you think about this text, how am I doing on time? Wow. Do you see how much God loves you? And if you're still overwhelmed with your guilt and your shame, you need to stand a little bit longer to realize how fiercely God defends you from your accuser. You need to remember how He has cleaned off your filthy clothes and given you beautiful new ones. And if you are embracing that knowledge and that truth, and that's where you live with the Lord, then His challenge to you is, don't be like this Leusink dog Sawyer. Don't go back and roll in the filth. In fact, I don't know if you're like this. When you get something new, like either a new jeans or a new car or something, and at least when I look at a car that's new to me, I'm like, kids, don't scratch it. Don't scratch it. And you know, after a while, you get a little used to it and whatever. But if you could be in this moment like Joshua, where you look and you see, these are my filthy clothes, and when the attraction, like our dog likes to roll them over, when you're like, oh, it looks good, it looks so good. I have this from the Lord. If you want to be inviting people underneath your fig tree so it doesn't stink, then remember, you need to walk in obedience to the Lord. And then when you're here, be like those two or guys in Ephesus that go, "We'd be much better over here." We invite people to experience the shade you have experienced with the Lord. So we are